vote is 4-0-1, and I note a quorum is present today, so I will call this meeting of the Transportation and Parking Commission to order for today's meeting of April 19th, 2016. My name is Ryan O'Donnell, I'm the Chair of the Commission, also the City Council for Ward 3. Let me note the audio and video recording of these proceedings, and let's begin, as we always do, with introductions, starting with our Vice Chair.
I'm Shalini Shara, I'm the Ward 4 City Councilor and the Vice Chair.
Jamie Fisher, Citizen Member.
Gary Hartwell, Citizen Member.
John Cartledge, Captain with the Police Department.
Ann Brooks, Planning Board.
Maggie Chan, DPW.
Wayne Fiden, Planning.
David Valletta, DPW.
Dave Pomerantz, Central Services.
Richard Cooper, Citizen.
Terry Ushko, DPW.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll begin with public comment. It's an opportunity for members of the public to speak on any issue you wish. We ask only you keep it to about 3 minutes. And it's also because we haven't posted the topics that may come up in advance, we generally can't engage in a back and forth. So it's an opportunity for you to state information to this commission. And if there is an item later on the agenda that you wish to speak to, you can certainly wait until that time, or you can speak twice. So having said that, are there any members of the public who would like to speak on any issue today?
Go ahead.
Yes, sir. And if you would state your name and address for the record.
My name is Rick Rubin. I live at 11 Circle in Cambridge, Massachusetts. I'm here today to ask a request for a parking sign to be removed and a parking sign that says something to the effect that 15-minute parking put on 3rd Belmont Avenue in front of Swift College Dining Service offices, Human Resources offices. For many years, there's been a sign there that said no parking, and I believe the college might have put a bump out there. I have pictures, I won't bore you with those today, but I have pictures of the bump out that delivery people use to deliver things, to drop things off. As a manager in dining services, I often enter the office, run upstairs, pick up something, and drive away. I've been ticketed numerous times for just being there for a few minutes to drop something off or pick something up, especially as we get into our commencement time when we're back and forth with our offices. So I appreciate if you would consider this option of putting a different parking sign there.
Okay. Thank you very much, and we'll can follow up.
Who will follow up?
You and I will.
Okay. Yes. That's a promise, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Some emails already.
All right, thank you.
Nancy Forrestal has arrived.
Sorry.
No, I don't know. Do we have room up here?
Yeah.
Where do we lose?
Their chairs are right there. I don't know. You're happy where you are?
I'm happy. I don't feel left out.
You don't have a complaint to lodge against Nancy. Okay. Well, Nancy Forrestal, for the record, is our parking enforcement officer who is an advisor to the commission. Any other public comment? Ms. Squires?
Hi. Once again, it's spring, and I'm just reminding everybody that I'm from, Michelle Squires, 30 Lincoln Avenue. A reminder that the tractor trailers have not gone away on Lincoln Avenue, and in the past month, the multiple neighbors and myself have seen actually the tractor trailers coming more than ever from the opposite direction, from the industrial park, where the signs say Canada are fine. So I think that I don't know what's going on, but you know, we have to find some way to enforce that. And just a little other thing that gets to me, because I work for the electric company, so I drive around a lot in my little Jeep. And plus, I live in the neighborhood at the light at Damon Road and the industrial park. A lot of people, and they did it to me just this morning, how convenient. They don't stop at that red light coming from King Street. I find that I don't jet out when my light turns green anymore, because more often than not, they're just, and obviously it's not even coming through a yellow light, it's after, because mine's already green, so that's all.
Just just a clarifying question. Thank you. Just a clarifying question. So people are just breezing through the red light on Damon Road coming from King Street.
Yeah. At least that first one. He said, I don't go out right away as soon as it turns green, because if I'm first in line, because this morning, it's not the first time it's happened to me that they're flying through that. And it's not, I mean, there's no sign saying it's there, but you know, they're stopping at the railroad tracks. And then, you know, so if they're just choosing not to, or because it's still fairly new to some people, that who knows?
We can certainly put something out about that.
Yeah.
Have some enforcement in that area.
Okay, so good. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comments to start with? Okay, we'll launch into our agenda. We do not yet have minutes for March 15th, 2016, so unless there's any objection, I'd like to wait for that, and actually we have no choice, so we'll be waiting. Any bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee updates today? Okay. Any updates from other departments, DPW?
Yes.
Ms. Chan?
Paving contract, 2016 paving contract. We are working on the estimate and the drawings. We're hoping the bid opening will be in May sometime. Crack ceiling contract. The crack ceiling contract was awarded to Crack Ceiling Inc. That should be happening during the summer. Traffic calming. For the previous five traffic calming applications, we will start doing the putting down the traffic counters that soon now that it's winding up. And DPW drafted a citywide sidewalk inventory request for proposals. We're looking to get an inventory of all the existing sidewalks and the conditions, so we can see which ones you prioritize to repair and if there are any missing sidewalk links for those two.
Great, thank you. Any questions for Ms. Chan? Is there an accessible place where the list of streets that are up for this year for repayment? Is there a place where that list exists?
Yes, it's on the Public Works Department webpage under current projects. You can see there's a memo for paving fiscal year 17 and a series of maps showing exactly what the areas are and what the closed treatment is. So that's just one of them.
Great. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much. No announcements or presentations today. No requests have come to this committee. We have a recommendation for an appointment. This is item 7A, the nomination and appointment of Todd Ford of 78 Fern Street in Florence to the Bicycle and Pedestrian Subcommittee. The way our rules require this to go is someone simply makes the nomination in this commission, and then we vote on it. I'm not sure if there are materials. I think Mr. Ford sent his resume along. If we don't have it in this meeting, I think it was sent around the last one. But anyway, that's on the agenda, but someone has to make the nomination officially.
So nominated.
Okay, Director Fyden nominates Todd Ford. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion on the nomination to the Bicycle and Pedestrian Subcommittee? Okay. All in favor? The appointment?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. So Mr. Ford is appointed unanimously. We're up to resolutions, orders, and ordinances. The first one is an ordinance relative to parking near the police station on Center Street. For the purpose of removing the current spot adjacent to the police station driveway, which is currently a 15-minute space, and making the next space over into a 15-minute space. And the ordinance is here. This was proposed originally from the chief of police, Jody Casper, who is not here today, but I don't know if Captain, you'd be able to speak to the issue at all.
Sure. When you are exiting the police department parking ramp and parking deck area, making a right-hand turn onto Center Street, if there's a car or large truck parked there, it's actually difficult to see, and it would just make it easier for anybody leaving the police department to exit more safely.
Are there any discussion, any questions or discussion on this ordinance?
The space that we want to make 15 units is a metered space? No, sorry.
I believe it is.
Yes. This came up for an advanced preview in the Legislative Matters Committee. Councilor Sherrod was in that committee as well. A couple of the other councilors raised the issue of generally losing parking spaces downtown. In that, if we do lose parking spaces downtown, they don't grow on trees necessarily, and we ought to be careful when we eliminate parking spaces. So that's something for us to consider in this commission if we're going to eliminate a space. You know, I think it's frequently the case that we remove spaces to improve lines of sight, but I do think we should also be cautious, because we would be doing that almost everywhere in the city, or many, many times in the city. So just to make that comment. Councilor?
And I thought I remembered that a little farther towards Main Street on Center Street, that there had been one or two parking spaces that were in front of the office for First Churches, or in front of the building that had table 9 in it, that were removed in the past few years. And I was, does anyone remember that? I think it, because there was a crosswalk that then was changed when the police station was changed. So I thought we'd already lost some spaces over there. I don't know if anyone recalls this. Am I the only person who remembers this? I worked right there, so. You remember?
I remember,
okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you. And I was wondering if anyone knew the reason for that, or whether maybe one of those could come back to replace the space.
I do not know.
I remember that happening. I don't know the reason, other than when the police department was being built, they did add those two crosswalks, one
right
where you mean, and then the other one down on Masonic Street. There was another one that's kind of there and kind of not there.
Right.
Those were intended to be temporary.
Right.
That's for knowledge of construction.
Mm-hmm. So I think actually that other space might be able to go back where that temporary spot would be. I don't think there was an issue other than the crosswalk is going to end up going there.
That would be great if we could swap those spaces and not lose the space.
Just to from another perspective, man, I don't spend a lot of time with PD, but when I'm there, cruisers are frequently going in and out, one coming in while one's going out, and that is a tough line of sight. I have parked in that, so the visitor's parking when I'm in there, I think if you were to lose the 15-minute spot, it also increases visibility for cars coming down Center Street. You're going to see a vehicle exiting that lot sooner than if the car was right at the driveway there. And if it's an emergency response, I think we need to be as positive and advantageous as we can to these officers getting in and out. So I would support it.
Okay. Well, what we can do at this stage is have more discussion. Someone can make a motion for a positive recommendation or another kind of recommendation. Someone can make a motion to postpone that. Those are the options that we have. Anyone like to make a motion? Go ahead, proceed.
I'd like to make a motion to accept it and to include a search for whether additional space could be added back further where it had been removed earlier.
Okay, so Ms. Brooks is making the motion for a positive recommendation on this ordinance, and is also just making a suggestion that we do some research on where it might be replaced, essentially,
yes.
Councilor Sherrod was mentioning.
Particularly since you think you have a place where it might be replaced.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the second part of that is just something we'll tackle in the future as a matter of discussion. Mm-hmm. So the motion will be a motion to make a positive recommendation for the ordinance. Okay. Is there a second on that motion?
Second.
Seconds. Is there any discussion on the motion for positive recommendation? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much. Item 8A is another ordinance. This is an ordinance to amend section 312-113C, schedule 12, stop and yield intersections. To add a yield sign at Venturers Field Road at the intersection of Henry Street and Montview Avenue. I guess I would ask Ms. Chan if she were to who produced this ordinance, because she put it together.
Yeah, pretty simple, there's already a yield sign there.
Okay.
But it's not in the ordinance.
I'm sorry, there was a what?
The yield sign is already in place.
Okay.
But it's not in the ordinance.
So we will.
Well then.
Conform with reality. All right, is there a motion on this ordinance?
So moved.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I guess I should say, I move that we accept the ordinance as proposed.
You move a positive recommendation for the ordinance?
That's what I meant to say.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Is there any discussion on the motion? Mr. Alves.
It's in the discussion items, and we talked about it, I think, at the last meeting. The citizen came forward about some extra stop signs and whatnot to keep cars from going crazy through that intersection. Is this ordinance meant to address that in any way, or are we still keeping that discussion topic open?
I just take a shot at answering that. I mean, it sounds like this would just be a matter of housekeeping to put a stop sign, a yield sign that already exists into the code, but I think the question about adding stop signs would still be an open question.
Yeah.
I wouldn't see
and
this.
I just would want to make sure we communicate the right thing to those citizens and not mm-hmm. make it sound like we push it through and ignore their help.
I think we can take this motion to be just about the yield sign, and it will not be about adding other signage to the intersection. Thank you. I agree with that. Any other discussion on the motion to approve? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? So that is approved unanimously as well. Item 8C is another ordinance. This is an ordinance to amend Section 312-104, Schedule 3, limited time parking to establish 2 1-hour parking spaces in Florence on Main Street on the southerly side near Chestnut Street. And Ms. Chan, could you introduce this as well?
Yes, we're looking to put in 2 parking spaces in front of the Northampton Cooperative Bank. Some residents were asking for this, so we took a look out there, and these spaces would be able to fit in front of that building.
So what's there now? Just no parking?
Right, there's no parking.
Any other discussion?
What does that do to the road width there? I can't really visualize it in terms of space for the car and bike traffic.
Apparently the width of that road is 40 feet, and by putting in those spaces it would make that travel lane about 11 feet, which would help slow down vehicles as well.
Suffice to say, no safety concerns from the department about this.
But what we're saying there then is it's an 11-foot auto lane shared with bike. Okay. How does that fit with the rest of the painting and whatnot along that roadway? Because obviously we do now have, they go all the way up to Florence, the bike lanes and everything.
It's shared lane markings. There's no bike lanes on Main Street.
I ride through there occasionally, and it is Sharrow's, and I've ridden through where those 2 parking spaces would be added. I think it would feel to me very similar to what it feels like on Friendly's, that corridor from, I guess it's Maple Street down through past Friendly's. After Friendly's, I think it opens up. Downstream parking ends at that point. And it goes to 3 lanes wide briefly at the intersection. And it's 3 lanes on both sides.
This is a by the gas station in Converse.
Yeah. So I think adding those 2 spaces it sort of makes sense that the roadway starts to veer to the, I guess it's to the east, if you're heading south. I think it would be fine. I've thought about it because I knew this was coming.
Okay. Any other discussion? Remember the public, Ms. Squires, you'd like to?
Yes.
Sure, feel free to.
Because we go to that bank all the time. And there's a driveway to the right of the bank, which is in between the 2 buildings. And then there's another driveway for the drive-through, an ATM. So actually, where would the parking spot, because it's hard, when you're coming out of either one of those, is the parking spot going to be in between those two driveways? Because it's kind of hard to see if you're coming out one or the other anyway, because you're, if you're taking a, if you're taking a left and you got the traffic coming up from, from the flats, it's hard enough getting out there right before the light as it is. And I don't know, I just don't know if it's in, it's just my concern, because I go to, both the parking area and the drive-through all the time. Like you're concerned at the police station of being blocking visibility, that maybe you just, I don't know if that was anything that you think you'd probably look at that. You probably did, but if you think it's not a problem, fine, but I'm just
well,
that.
It appears to be, I mean, the two spots are directly in front of that, essentially, so it is in between the two entrances.
The two driveways,
And I do know the distance, but I assume the distance is greater than 3 feet between the end of the parking spaces. It's just generally the standard.
Yeah.
So, because that's the information.
Just concerned about being able to see getting out of there, that's all.
You can also exit out the back, right?
Yeah, you can. You can go out Pine Street. Yeah, you can. But not if you're going through the drive through, you can't.
Right.
Okay. Any other discussion on this matter? Is there a motion on this ordinance?
I move to make a positive recommendation.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion for positive recommendation? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Very good. So now we're in the discussion item section. Lincoln Avenue is on the agenda, but I believe there are more residents from Lincoln Avenue.
Well, there's supposed to be a couple. It's at that, it's school vacation week and a lot of the families are away. So, but there was supposed to be at least one other person coming, but I don't know where she is. But
oh, it makes sense to wait.
You can wait a few.
And take that later.
Sure.
Great. Another question, is there anyone from the PBTA here? So we're going to have a follow-up discussion about the placement of bus shelters, which pertains to item B, expanding the bus stop in front of the Academy of Music by removing parking spots. So I guess we'll just wait on that one. Yeah, B and C, right, are both related to that. So unless there's any objections, I'd like to continue items B and C. But back to item A is a discussion of traffic calming for the top five currently queued traffic calming projects, which are State Street and Trumbull Road, which is traffic calming application number 4, Bay State Association and Riverside Drive, that's traffic calming application number 1, Florence Road and Ryan Road, number 10, Niatuck Street and Elm Street, number 27, and Bridge Road, number 22. Just to introduce this, we've gotten a lot of traffic calming requests from various streets since I've been on the commission, over 2 years. And at the same time, we've had old ones that have been ranked for a long, long time. I think the Bay State Association one, for example, it's traffic calming number 1. I think it was ranked in 2008 or something like that. And I just feel that as a commission, we should get in the habit of looking at the traffic calming projects that we have sort of agreed would be good to explore, and then see about spending some of the money that's budgeted to actually put in traffic calming, if appropriate. So the idea for this discussion item was just to look at the top five that have been ranked and have been hanging around. So I asked our traffic engineer and the DPW to kind of take a look at this, and I don't know if you have something to share with us today about the top five.
A handout?
You have handouts.
Summary of the top five.
Okay.
Sure. So the numbers that are here, the TCA numbers, those aren't the ranking numbers. Those are the numbers at which they came in.
Exactly.
Okay.
As these are being passed around, just for anyone who doesn't know, the public or anyone who for some reason is watching this on YouTube later. We have this process whereby applications come in, and if they are voted forward after a study of traffic speed and volume and vehicle type and that kind of thing, each project is assigned a ranking based on a number of factors to establish its priority, essentially. And the idea is that you want to have traffic calming projects be tackled in a fair order, so we're fair to all the streets, and so that's what we mean by ranking. So, Ms. Chen, do you want to provide an overview of, we lean very heavily on 90 Chen's. Do you want to explain your handout?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So for each of the traffic calming applications, I have a little summary chart with the AET, 85th percentile speed, and the truck percentage, and also some notes at the bottom.
Yeah, please.
Sure.
Yeah.
So State Street, the average daily traffic is between 7,000 and 9,000 vehicles per day. And the speed, 85th percentile, is over 2 to 7 miles per hour over the posted speed limit. And there's fairly low truck percentage on State Street. So a temporary speed hump was installed at 125 State Street in 2010 in front of the Red Cross building. And speed humps are usually installed if the AET is below 4,000 units per day. So I'm not sure why it was installed in the past.
Okay. And is there a current recommendation for what we might do to on State Street to satisfy the traffic calming request? Or is that kind of yet to be determined?
I think this is more of just a status update. We don't really have recommendations for all.
Okay. Is there, in general, I mean, is it the opinion of the DPW that it would be possible and appropriate to develop proposals on how to proceed with some of these, just because we have money in the budget for traffic calming, and these are sort of our ostensibly our formally our highest priority traffic calming projects. So, or do they deserve to be revisited in some cases because they've been around for a while? Yeah. Well, how do you think we should proceed with our existing traffic calming projects? I guess is my question. I mean, my thought is that either we revisit them, revisit the wisdom of doing traffic calming at all. You know, like I say, I mean, the Bay State Association was 8 years ago. Or we try to figure out a recommendation for what traffic calming to do, whether it's sidewalks or crosswalks or speed bumps or whatever, and see if we can get that funded as put into the capital plan for the city. So that's what would seem to make sense to me.
So a few of them do have recommendations. I guess I should correct myself.
Okay.
Because temporary speed humps were put in the past, mm-hmm. and they did show a decrease in speed, but I guess there was not enough funding in the past to put in permanent ones. So some of the other ones,
okay.
we could look to put in permanent speed humps, but for State Street, don't have a recommendation.
Okay, well, so for now, do you want to move on to the other ones, and that maybe will help answer the general question? Okay, no, that's fine.
Can I just ask a quick question?
Go right ahead.
Were you saying that there, generally a street with this much traffic wouldn't have a temporary speed hump installed?
Speed humps usually, so there's, I have a chart here, tells certain traffic calming devices should be put in depending on the traffic volume. So for speed humps, it should be the AET should be less than 4,000 vehicles per day. And the speed limit should be less than 30 miles per hour.
Okay. And the speed limit on State is less than 30.
25.
But it has more volume than
right.
the recommendation. So is there a recommendation for a street with that kind of volume?
Crosswalks would be an acceptable tour of what the volume is for Raised crosswalks.
Raised crosswalks would be $7,500, which is closer to what we had.
Still a little bit under what is recommended, but might be acceptable in this case. But that's not something that was looked at on State Street originally. I'm not sure that we had this information available at the time.
Okay.
Is there a recommendation for Sharrows, when to put Sharrows? Because it seems like it's downtown, and at the other end of State Street is a grocery store. It seems like Sharrows might make a lot of sense. The rail trail is at the end of State Street.
Awesome.
I've often thought that that might be good. I ride State Street quite often. It seemed like it might be a good place for, you know, something like that.
Brooks?
Wayne, isn't this the area that we were looking at with the bike?
So that's one of the things that Nelson, Malta's looking at.
Right.
In terms of their recommendation.
For exactly the same kind of issues, maybe we should let that particular thing come through during the course of the summer and revisit this at the end of that study, because this was on the agenda for the study that's ongoing at this stage of the game.
Okay. So
it is being looked at.
So this is being looked at as part of the consultant, the comprehensive bicycle and pedestrian plan that the city is doing.
Indeed, because of where the bike path comes in and how people have to take it into town.
Okay. That's certainly fine with me. That seems like that would be an enlightening process. Okay. Any other discussion on State Street?
Well, yes. Maybe I could just say something in general. I think it's been noted that until very recently, there had been no funding for the kinds of traffic calming measures that had been looked at, speed humps and that sort of thing. And recently, we've received some capital improvements money to be able to do some of these projects. It's not something that we've tried to do as standalone projects, except for local speed humps on places like Union Street and William Street and Holly Street. Those have been done in-house by the DPW, and based on recent conversations with the highway superintendent, those speed humps cost about $5,000 a piece to install in-house. Pretty low-cost item, and would certainly be well within the budgetary allowances that are provided for capital improvements. We have not looked at the cost and expense of doing something more complicated like a raised crosswalk or a raised intersection. That's going to chew up a lot of money a lot more quickly, because it also requires that the drainage be something that can be worked out so that it doesn't create ponding behind those kinds of structures. I just want to let people know that we're in a little bit of a conundrum about what kind of projects make sense within the scope of funds that we have available. On the one hand, we have the sort of low-hanging fruit, fairly inexpensive speed humps, some sort of striping, whether it's Sharrows or maybe some edge line markings to make the road look visibly narrower. But when we get into more detailed projects such as raised crosswalks, that may actually deplete the available monies fairly quickly. Particularly if they're standalone projects and aren't necessarily rolled in with some other larger projects. So just wanted to give people a little bit of a context that we're still feeling our way around a little bit, where we're going and where the TPC would like to see us go with respect to some of these traffic calming measures.
I think that's an excellent point. I do think there's a role for the commission in helping shape a policy or a direction. So I don't think we'll do that today, but hopefully that's something we can take on. I think this is a good start looking at the top five. Those points are worth making. Any other discussion? Should we move on to Bay State Village?
Bay State Village, the average daily traffic is below 4,000 vehicles per day, so that's the household work on the street. People travel 8 to 12 miles above the speed limit on the street. And again, one between Liberty Street and Norwood Ave, and one between Norwood Ave and Hinkley Street, and those show the increase in speeding about 8 miles, I think 6 to 8 miles. So we'd be inclined to put in permanent humps at those locations.
You would? Okay.
Yes, with the residents.
Actually, yes, that's a thought. I remember some of the speed, the temporary speed humps, residents really didn't like the noise. Do you have it in the records of which ones people didn't object to?
I think it's the people who live directly in front of it. Everyone else was approved of it.
So this was actually something that Maggie and I were discussing before this meeting, and I don't know, maybe the commission wants to think about how this might best be approached. Obviously, with some infrastructure, the people that are immediately in front of it tend to be the most impacted, and yet there might be some question about the common good versus an individual concern. So what we don't know is how, what the approach or policy should be to determine whether or not speed humps can be put in at a given location. If there are only one or two people that object, is that sufficient to veto the whole idea of speed humps at that location, or should be there be some sort of procedure where maybe there is a canvassing of people within 500 feet of the expense of those speed humps, and that a certain percentage in favor would actually overrule an objection? I'm throwing it out there to you because I don't know how we decide that.
Is the noise from the cars or from the, if you've got a temporary speed hump, it's not of the same material that a permanent one would be?
It's not of the same material, but you're still going to have the same.
It's the automobile itself.
It's the vehicle going over the hump, and the more surprised you might be going
yes.
over the hump, the more loud chances are it will
yes.
be as a result.
Not the sound of, you're not talking about the sound of cursing or anything.
Well, that may come later.
Okay.
But if you approach it at the speed at which it's supposed to be traversed, it will be, shouldn't be as much of an issue in terms of sound as if you decide to take it a little bit more quickly.
Do we get complaints about those speed bumps that are currently in place?
Sometimes, yeah. Speaking for myself.
Noises, I mean noise-wise, if this is the issue.
I can't think of one off the top of my head.
Okay.
People feel different. I know someone on William Street who lives right in front of the speed bump, and she really loves it. I guess it is.
Depends on the vehicle, too.
Sure.
An empty box truck that has a little bit of stuff in it,
yep.
It's going to make a lot more noise than a small passenger vehicle. Yeah.
But I think you highlight an important principle, which is the whole reason why we have a commission is we want to take politics out of decision making to a certain degree and have a process that's fair. Because otherwise we would just be giving some people and giving people what they want just for asking, and then if someone else opposed it, we may scrap the project because someone opposed it, and that wouldn't be the right thing to do. So I appreciate you raising that. It sounds like we should revisit a policy more globally going forward. I'll tell you, in the case of Bay State, I'm actually supposed to talk to the Bay State Neighborhood Association next week, either Tuesday or Wednesday, so I can certainly provide them with the update and ask the question about whether residents objected back then or whether any might object now. And maybe, you know, it might be something where they go out and do canvas and talk to the neighbors before anything happens like that.
The other thing with this location is that it is actually a fairly long stretch, and the two that were put in temporarily were, I think, between Norwood and Hinkley, is that right? And that only really addresses one end of that long stretch. So it would be our general approach that if it was appropriate to put in two at that stretch, that we would do that initially and see what kind of benefit that provided, but would consider doing another set towards the other end to try to break up the entire speed at the same time, we're a little bit reluctant to just go ahead and pepper streets with speed humps endlessly. And as you'll see, some of these other streets, they're long stretches, and the speed humps are most effective if they're spaced no greater than 750 feet apart. And if you start talking about roadways that are thousands of feet long, that adds up in terms of the number that would consider to be effective over the entire stretch. So there's some decision making as well as to what's the priority location for the speed humps if you don't want to end up with 6 or 8 or 10 over a whole length of roadway.
But there are always going to be more speeding on the longer streets than the shorter ones, so it's really an issue.
And I don't have the answer. I'm just pointing out some of the things that one needs to struggle with in order to try to make a decision about what is appropriate.
Okay. Anything else on Bay State?
Somebody raising hand.
Oh, please.
I hope sure, we'll come comment on. Really quick. Christine Greg Mullen, I'm on the Amherst Public Works Committee, and I'm here just watching, but we've dealt with this and we're dealing with this, and how many do you add and all that. And I just want to bring up the issue of signage, because when we have had longer runs and we've, you know, added 3 or 4 speed humps or bumps, then I'm not sure what kind of signage you put, especially if you're going from temporary to permanent ones. But we have like 3 signs on a pole, and if you have them at every bump, then after you put them in, most people love them. But we actually got a lot of feedback that it changed the look of the street because there's all this signage all the way down the street with these big yellow signs. So I just wanted to point to that something to think about too.
I think that's a good point. Now, North Street was beautifully redone, but of course it's replete with signage. I think there's also a psychological element to human beings where at a certain point you just stop looking at the signs because you can't process all of them. Someone has probably written a paper on that. Mm-hmm. But I think, thank you for that point. Can we move on to Florence Road and Ryan Road, the third highest ranked project? And so this is another one where there's no clear recommendation about what we might do.
No.
Oh, this says aiming to place temporary humps. Because you're going to do a trial.
We were planning on doing a trial, but I said before that the average speed humps, you should have an average of traffic below 4,000 vehicles per day.
Okay. So you think that just disqualifies it from receiving the speed?
I think that you could. It's not as high as State Street, which is around 9,000. So maybe we could do a test trial and put them in to see the effect.
Councilor and Mr. Romo.
Is that because, are they not recommended for high volume because of wear and tear, that just too many cars going over speed hump just doesn't, they don't hold up to it, or why are they not recommended for volume?
Recommended for local streets, so residential streets where there are more houses and that are lower volume, or lower speed. But I guess State Street is 25 miles per hour.
Yeah, I mean, it's residential and it's 25 miles per hour. It just has a lot of high volume.
Mr. Harlow.
I was curious what the statistics show on sharrows or bike lanes as opposed to speed humps. At what point do you rule out speed humps but introduce bike lanes? For instance, the road width is 30 feet and 32 feet, which if you allotted 11 feet for vehicles, that would give you 5 feet or 6 feet for lanes on each side.
Is there a lot of parking along the street? we might eliminate parking if we were to put in on both sides.
What about Sharrows with parking? Well, so I'm actually curious about the statistic. What statistically shows as being effective traffic calming measures? I mean, the idea is to reduce speed.
I haven't seen much research on Sharrows.
Any other discussion on this street? We have two other ones, so we can continue the general discussion. Nonotuck Street and Elm Street. This is a fairly recent application that came to us, but yet it is already at number four. I think we might be familiar with the nature of the problem, although feel free to recap, but I mean, feel free to not recap also. Does the DPW have any thoughts on what might be the next step for Nonotuck Street and Elm Street? Since we've already ranked it as a strong candidate for traffic.
I think we were looking to put in temporary humps between Maple Street and
Maple
Street.
Okay.
We still are planning on putting a raised crosswalk at Maple Street.
So you will put in the raised crosswalk across Nonotuck Street, no matter what, but you may also add two temporary ones to gauge. Okay. And that's kind of for the spring at some point, spring or summer.
As we can get to it.
Okay, yeah. No, not trying to hold you to it, just curious. Any discussion on Nonotuck Elm Street? Was there ever any resolution on the fact that it's an emergency route? Okay, I see you have here actually, both Nonotuck and Elm Street are secondary routes for police and fire. I guess I've heard that, you know, if ambulances are going over, for example, you don't want speed bumps. I don't know if that's a law of the universe or if that's just a judgment call in each case, but.
You see that.
But suffice it to say, the fact that it's a secondary emergency route, from the DPW's perspective, it doesn't present a problem.
Can you shed any light on the difference between primary and secondary emergency routes?
I would say we've definitely heard an ambulance response with a speed bump, because you're gonna, especially if you have a patient in the back, you're gonna slow down to almost zero. And if they hit it at a speed that's not good, the patient could be in danger as well. As far as response in a fire truck or a police cruiser, I would think it's gonna have to be considered, because we're gonna have to slow way down, obviously, to hit it at appropriate speeds. Mm-hmm. When you could damage vehicles too if you're not slowing down properly as well. So mm-hmm. I think it's definitely could be an issue.
But that doesn't really, I mean, we already have speed humps in the city, so obviously there could be emergency response in any one of those locations where there are speed humps, whether it's ambulance, fire, or police, so they can be negotiated, right?
Right.
The question I had was what's the significance of a secondary emergency route versus?
Yeah, I think going from downtown to Florence, that's a major cut through to like the Burt's Pit Road and that whole section of Florence, rather than going over Route 9 through the center of town. And we use that quite a bit, going from Elm Street up to Nonotuck. So it's definitely, I know there are other speed bumps in the city, but not on major routes that we would use on a daily basis.
But we have to make the distinction between speed humps and speed tables or raised crosswalks, because we certainly have them on North Street, and that's the primary emergency route. As far as I understand it, it doesn't seem to be a problem.
Well, it might be a question for the fire rescue department as well to get their perspective in addition to the police department. For example, I just anecdotally, I know there was discussion of speed bumps on Prospect Avenue at one point. And Prospect Avenue is, I think, a street that lot of ambulances, even ones that come from Amherst, actually. They go to Denton Road and then Bridge Road, and then they cut over to the hospital at that location. And so it was always seen as a problem to add speed bumps there, and I could understand why. So, yeah, so I guess I would say we want to straighten that out before acting. So I can make a note to send a note to the fire rescue chief just to inform him about this discussion today. We can go from there. Okay? All right. Yes, Mr. Clark.
Can I have clarification of when you use speed humps, speed bumps, speed tables? I mean, we don't have any speed tables in Northampton, do
we? We have raised crosswalks. A speed table is essentially a raised crosswalk without a crosswalk. Okay. So we try to sort of combine things if we can.
And a speed bump versus a speed hump, are they the same?
The speed hump is actually doesn't cover the full width of the road, so there's still a gutter line at the edges, so the drainage is, doesn't create as much of an issue, but it covers enough of the span of the road that vehicles are required to negotiate it to slow down.
Mr. Harwin?
In the intersection at College Lane and Elm Street, that's a speed table.
Okay.
And it's basically a four-corner crosswalk.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Bridge Road? Is there anything to report on the Bridge Road? I thought we had sort of completed that one, actually.
We installed
the
flashing beacon,
okay,
and the Kangaroo at the flashing beacon at that location.
Okay. So that one's all set. Have you heard any response? You received thank you cards in the mail? I hope you have.
The first week.
Okay.
The second week is different.
Okay. Well, thank any discussion on Bridge Road. All right. Well, I think it's safe to say this is as a general matter, we'll be following up on this in future meetings. I think this was a productive discussion on the top five, so thank you. I'd like to take things out of order just out of consideration for our guests. I would like to move up item G, which is Lincoln Avenue. I see three people from Lincoln Avenue here at least. Last meeting, we had a discussion of a traffic calming application from Lincoln Avenue. You've just heard a discussion of other traffic calming applications for other streets. Lincoln Avenue is a little bit different and has its unique challenges because, while the other streets, you can see, not many of them have high truck traffic. Lincoln Avenue does have substantially high truck traffic. But another difference is Lincoln Avenue, there's no reported speeding over the speed limit that exists, which is 30 miles an hour. So that is another difference between Lincoln Avenue and the other streets that make the whole traffic calming issue a unique challenge. So that's the overview. And at that meeting, we decided not to take a vote on ranking Lincoln Avenue. Those who would favor immediate traffic calming on Lincoln Avenue might be concerned that the ranking would be so low, you would probably never see that. And on the other hand, you might think that if a street doesn't have recorded speeding on it, according to the posted speed limit, it ought not be ranked. So for those two reasons, on either end of the spectrum, no vote was taken. But we agreed to take it up again. And in one of the things that was raised was whether painting up on the street, blind painting on the street, might be something to explore. Maybe there are other things as well. So to start, if it's okay, I don't know if our traffic engineer, again, wants to provide any information about line painting and research that you've done or looked at for effective line painting on traffic.
I haven't found any information about edge lines decreasing speed. However, it increases safety
so that people don't swerve off the road, erase their awareness where they're supposed to drive,
but it doesn't decrease speeds by putting in edge lines and center lines.
Have you seen any research whether it increases speeds or it's just a flat out difference? Okay. My concern is I wanted to have some research to, or look for some research to, as a starting point before we start talking about Canyon Street. Okay, well, thank you for that. Is there any other discussion first from any members of the commission as a follow-up to our discussion on Lincoln Avenue in the last meeting?
Is the objective here to keep the trucks off the road by making it a road trucks don't want to go down?
Yeah.
Be helpful.
That's right.
For but, some that maybe.
Yeah, but it's not the speed, it's the trucks.
My opinion is you have two separate but related issues, and the trucks are a huge problem. And if you ask people on the street, they will say speeding is a problem as well. There does not appear to be speeding over 30 miles an hour. That yeah. doesn't mean that to the residents it's not a problem.
Is there something that prevents us from making the speed 25 miles an hour?
State law. I mean,
there is, in other words. Yes. That's a limitation to which there is no backing out.
Well, if we were to try to change the speed limit, we would have to petition the state. They would essentially do their own study and analysis, and then they would come back and say, here it is, and then we would live with whatever they tell us.
Okay.
So
if we kept the trucks off of Lincoln, what does that do to the street next to it or the street next to that? I'm just sort of trying to figure out.
Well, I think insofar as, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
And to answer that question, insofar as truck traffic is part of traffic calming, and we should therefore discuss it today, I think trucks going down the street is a big problem because they're not supposed to. They're only supposed to go down the street if it's a real emergency and a mistake, but they're going down and it's a matter of course.
I recognize that.
Oh yeah, and so I think there's agreement generally. And in recognition of that, you know, a number of things have been done. Signage has been placed on the exit for the highway. Additional signage was placed last year, warning of the fines on the side streets. But the problem has not been solved, so one of the things we did another traffic study. One had been done a few years ago to get updated information. And indeed, the data is different. And I think it's because there was North Street construction happening when the first data was gathered. So I think it's helpful to have the new data, and now we're sort of left with the same question again, is how do we deal with the truck traffic?
If we have the truck traffic off that street, is there any reason to think it wouldn't go onto the next street, I guess is another question.
It's allowed on the street, but in case of emergency, it's posted that they're not allowed on the other streets.
Technically, they're allowed to go down Lincoln Avenue in one direction from Bridge Street to North Street. But in reality, it's only for emergency purposes, to give them an out so they don't strike the bridge.
Enforcement on the street. I mean, I don't think it would take long for a few $300 tickets to get back to every company along Industrial, the road there, and they'll be telling their delivery people to go down the inner road.
These are repeat trucks, I suspect.
Right, I mean,
yeah.
Might be a question tailor-made for Captain Carlin.
The operator and the trucks are the ones actually getting the citation, so I think the individual person wouldn't necessarily go down the street again. But then the next, you know, we've had enforcement out there. I haven't been to all of these meetings, but the ones I have been to, we immediately put out something for officers to do more enforcement in those areas. I mean, we can't be out there 24/7 either. Yes. We have limited resources and we try our best to enforce them. But there are a variety of trucks and different companies who are coming into that area, and I don't know if the tickets affect them or not. You know, I mean, it's a hefty fine, but. Yeah.
I mean, no one wants to ruin someone's day or month or whatever with a big ticket, but if there was some information, how many tickets have been issued, you know, did that make a difference? You know, I think the residents would probably see it pretty quick. You know, if we had some benchmark to go on, like, you know, rather than just saying, you know, we need to start patrolling that area.
Do we have data on tickets?
I do have the data.
But does it make it exist?
We can make this.
We have a few more discussion items, and we do have residents who want to get to speak as well. Is that okay if we let residents go first, and we can continue? Okay. So, Mr. Squires.
Just a quick, Joe Squires, looking at your comment about ruining people's days. These trucks are ruining our lives 24/7. And they speed. I realize you did a study. What did it last, 10 days, 2 weeks?
I don't know the duration. About a week?
For 7 years, if not longer, I've been fighting this battle. Angela Plasman, Owen Freeman Daniels, Ryan O'Donnell, David Markowitz. We've been meeting at the coal plants. Signs. Doesn't work. Try sleeping at night. Little kids. I'm repeating myself all the time. Thank you.
I guess just a question, because listening talk about where speed bumps have been, where they probably shouldn't have ever been, like State Street by Red Cross. You said you didn't know how that passed, how that got through, because with the statistics, it probably shouldn't have been. Is that what you said before? Something like, I'm just saying. So, and I know the speed, we talked about the speed limit before. What's Riverside Drive speed limit? 25 miles an hour? What's Riverside Drive?
I'll have to check. I'll check why.
I just know there's longer streets, you know, Barrett Street's only 25 miles.
30 miles an hour.
Huh?
30?
Like 30? Yeah. I mean, our street's not all that long. There's other streets that are double our length that have a lower speed limit. And if we can't do it through the state, if it's the easier route is to put a speed bump with, you know, slow down speed bump 20 miles an hour in the middle of the street, maybe that's one way of going around the state. And just saying, I don't know.
I personally think a speed bump or pump for the trucks would really divert them and get them off that street.
That word would get around in no time.
They're going to be annoyed at hitting that thing. And although I think you're right, they're going to go obviously somewhere else, but
they might just follow the sign coming off the highway like they're supposed to. I mean, or I don't know, but I
know if the speed, like you said, is not, it's showing that people aren't speeding and there's not the other data, but I think a speed hump would divert these trucks off the street, especially if it was there for a reasonable amount of time.
But you try to get up to 30 miles an hour going on that street. I mean, with all the little kids, Chris, there's like 20 of them. It's just crazy. So it's, I don't know. I just think that we could go, even if we did temporary ones, but just to see what happens, you know, to and put those, you know, signs, you know, they say they're coming up. So I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, the traffic is seasonal. Isn't it?
Oh, Debbie, they're going to be revving up big time.
That was my question. Is there a high season for trucks?
June, July,
Why is that?
Because they produce those fruit drinks, and they're
still operating 24.
Yeah,
still
but it's not that the quantity is not as heavy in the winter time. In the
kids
fall,
aren't out there as much.
Well, no, I know, but we're talking Coca-Cola here.
No,
so,
I know.
Yeah, but yes, but the kids aren't out as much like in the summertime either. So, but and I still think, you know, I don't know, with the enforcing the $300 fine, one of my neighbors mentioned that we need to have a camera somewhere, but that would be the way they could, I mean, I assume that's legal to find somebody up with something they should see on a camera. I don't know. If it was at, say, by Coca-Cola and you actually got had on film which trucks are coming back into our neighborhood, at least that one way would help. I mean,
You don't know who's operating and I don't know the legality of that. I know the turnpike does it on the toll booths, like if you don't pay, they'll send you a citation.
Right.
But I don't know the legality.
Right, because aren't there some, like some, not so much in town, but other places where they have that at traffic signals so that they're getting like people who are pulling, stop signs, red lights and stuff. So, but I don't know.
My comment in reaction to today and also what I've been thinking since we did the new study is, I mean, it seems like the truck issue, people can quibble with how I phrase it, but it seems like that is the essential issue. Because if you look at speeding, relative to the 30 mile an hour speed that has been established by law, there's just not much over that. So it seems like the priority for...
But it's still too fast for our street.
Well, that may be, but in the realm of things that focus on, it seems like the truck traffic is maybe even more than half of the whole problem in terms of how it feels to live on the streets. So.
And as to whether or not they'll go down the other streets, I mean, there's signs, but there's still trucks that go down Day Avenue with those signs and whatever. They squeeze down that street,
The sign on Day Avenue where I live is always knocked to the ground by a truck.
and they're not supposed to. I mean, there's signs at both ends. I don't know. And then the alternate route going down to the light before the underpass and going left and coming around, and I've met tractor trailers coming up, Phillips Place or Butler's Place, Butler and trying to get her around on Pomeroy, and the whole situation is a nightmare. They would just watch the sign coming off the highway and go straight. But like I said, I talked to the Mass DOT before, about when it said, hopefully we could do something, and I repeat myself with a roundabout, in a couple of years when they do that.
Well, that will happen.
So they have better signage and whatever else to get them going there. But for now, we'll see. So, okay, thank you.
Okay.
Sorry, Ms. Price, can I ask you a quick question before you sit down?
Oh, yeah.
So, you heard the discussion about that some residents have concerns with speed bumps about the noise. Since there's still going to be some trucks that go down the street, are you at all concerned about that a truck going over a speed bump is going to be noisier than a car? That would...
Absolutely not. Those trucks wake us up anyway. You guys, what do you think?
Put spikes out there.
Yeah. No, that is not going to make a difference to us at all. Because when they're coming through at 2 or 3 or 4 a.m., they're waking up. So it's, it doesn't, not going to matter if they slow down for a speed bump.
I don't believe we have a policy on spikes, do we?
No.
Okay. Ms. Choi, do you want to provide anything today?
Everything, or you got anything else?
Everything. Certainly welcome to.
If there's anything else you think we missed.
Well, we have had discussions on our street about doing just private fundraising and seeing if there were ways that we could take, just do some actions on our own without being penalized. So I think that might involve suspending some sort of guidelines, which you said this is an advisory body only, but what might be some guidelines around that? Like not waiting for the city to do something, but doing something ourselves.
Well, hopefully everything that's done is within the...
Yeah, Joe's not going to put spikes out, don't worry.
So I see him in his backyard sharpening.
No, I got small ones, don't worry.
I think the challenge is to get, there are several layers of frustrating laws and regulations to deal with, some of which we've assumed voluntarily, like the traffic calming process,
Well, as I mentioned last time, I think we're looking at the same data and taking very different conclusions from it. So, as Michelle said, we are a very short street, so when you do get up to 30 miles an hour, you're going pretty fast, and people skid around the corner, you can hear their tires squeaking by W tire, which, conveniently, I guess. But I guess just some ideas about how we can not have to wait years, and maybe even doing some initiatives which might take years, like petitioning the state to lower the speed limit. Just maybe doing parallel processes.
Yeah, I mean, I can tell you, I mean, there's state legislation, I think, every year to lower the prima facie, speed limit to 20 or 25. And, you know, I know New York City has created these zones. I don't know what New York state law is, but I know New York has created whole zones in their block system where you can't go above a certain speed limit, safety zones. So I know those efforts exist, and I understand why. I mean, you can make a powerful argument for, especially on a short street. I'm not sure how much time you save going down a street the size of Lincoln Avenue or Day Avenue 10 miles faster. I mean, probably almost nothing mathematically, so it's strange.
And we do have a lot of trucks that are going the wrong way, where we have the sign that says $300 fine, which they, I'm sure, scoff. And there's also some statements from Coca-Cola that a lot of these drivers don't read or speak English, like they're from Quebec or who knows. And I wonder, you know, why are there so many drivers on the roads who don't read or speak English, apparently. But there are also some universal signs like a circle and slash, which I think that they understand. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
I have something I forgot.
Come.
It's quickie.
You need to
On the Prince Street end, there's a sign when you come down that says children, and they did add a sign about the air brakes of trucks. Somebody put it there. It was there after I came back from vacation. I don't know. But on the other end, because, you know, we had all our own signs, we tried that, and somebody stole them all. I do have one little plastic one left that they put on the North Street end.
Okay.
But I'm asking for a permanent children's sign underneath the speed limit sign there. I have a plastic one there now, but. And we've had, I mean, the guy, one of the neighbors is a carpentry teacher at Smith School, and he made some nice sandwich signs, and one of those got stolen too. It's so, trying to do it ourselves, somebody keeps, I mean, for a lot of, for Watch for Children and stolen stuff, but I don't know if they, you know, how much trouble it is. I'd say they can just put it right underneath the speed limit 30 sign, just children on the North Street end. Mm-hmm. There is one on the other end.
And there's one on Elizabeth, I know, and some of the other streets.
Yeah, there's not one coming off the North Street, that's all, where they're zipping around there.
I mean, thank you.
Okay.
I guess my statement on that is I don't know how much a sign that says children actually is effective at slowing traffic, to be honest.
No, I know that, but just to make them aware,
yeah.
You know.
Well, I don't know what our policy is on that. We probably don't have a written policy, but I certainly wouldn't be opposed to a sign that says children. I think we would still be, we still have a major problem.
Oh, absolutely. That's just little.
Yeah. Well, I'd recommend that's something that low-hanging fruit thing you could discuss. Yes?
I have some quick question.
Come on.
I might have missed it. I'm unfamiliar with the street. I sympathize with the trucks. How wide are the lanes, travel lanes right now?
It's an unstriped street with
unstriped
with parking on both sides of the street allowed.
And the width of the road, or how wide of the travel lanes?
Maybe it's 30 feet.
So the trucks have like 12 feet.
If cars are parked on both sides, it's
I think it's wider than 30.
And my last question, do they cars park there at night, or is that mostly during the day?
At night also, yes.
We try to get more people to park out there on purpose.
Just to slow the traffic down.
But they have new cars, they don't want to get them hit.
Because they've been hit.
Thank you.
When we talked about painting, did we talk about painting parking spaces? I know we talked about center lines and stuff like that, but what if we painted parking, you know, with the boxed in the parking spaces.
I think there'd be enough space for parking lines on both sides.
Even though there's...
If you're putting in an 8-foot wide parking lane on both sides.
Uh-huh. Do you know though there is parking on both sides, there wouldn't be enough room to paint them?
It's like Prospect Avenue in that way. There's not enough pavement to put in lines for parking and still have normal travel lanes left over. If you go down Prospect, everybody's parked up somewhat on both sides, and so everybody has to serpentine movement across the government center line. So it's a similar situation on Lincoln.
Mr. Cooper.
Does the city have an inventory of temporary speed humps, those rubber things that they've
run? They have one at this point.
And is it being used anywhere?
It was intended to be put out on Florence Road this spring.
What do they cost?
I don't know. We're going to look into getting a second one.
I know one of the issues in the past of those temporary ones is that they have to be taken up in the wintertime, but if the problem is exacerbated in the summer down there, it seems like that would be a pretty quick fix to see if it makes a difference, and if you can retrain enough truck drivers.
Well, the other thing with the temporary speed humps that we have is it's actually it's a substantial speed hump. It's not just something like you have in a parking lot. So these have to get actually driven down into the pavement with spikes, so you actually are degrading the pavement. The idea is that we put one in with the hope that that's actually the location you would put a permanent one in, so that you'd be able to cover your tracks, so to speak. It's not the sort of thing that you would reinstall on a seasonal basis, I don't think. I could be wrong. We could look into that and see, but that's my sensibility.
But if you put it in at this stage of the game and you do a study to make determination whether or not this makes a difference, wouldn't that be a very strong sign that this might resolve this problem, which clearly isn't going away any other way? I mean, maybe it's worthwhile to degrade the street to see whether or not this is the answer, because every other potential answer seems to not be an answer. And this is the only one that seems to have any prospect to it.
Well, Ms. Chen.
I mean, we have this traffic calming program. Mm-hmm. If we put in a speed hump on Lincoln Avenue, wouldn't that be skipping everything that's on the list there?
If we built a permanent one, certainly.
Well, except that as you said, it's discussing a different issue. It's not discussing the issue of speed.
Right.
I mean, this proposed hump on Lincoln Avenue is not a speed hump. It's a truck diverter.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
I mean, it has a
you
different.
Just invented something.
It's having a different purpose in some ways.
Yeah.
Right. Is that
yes.
How I'm understanding.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you.
One more quick.
Sure.
I just want to clarify. The trucks are heavier in the summertime, but they're there all the time. So that's all. It's something that we need year round, not, but it'd be a good time to test it out when it's heavier, so.
I just remembered an incident where the city was excavating right in front of our house, and so there was no way for trucks to pass, and somehow they did communicate with each other not to turn down Lincoln. So I think that it would be effective.
So they're like velociraptors, sort of. They're intelligent.
And they have like a group mind.
Interesting. Right.
Or they have CB radios.
I see. Oh, no, that's probably the reason. That's probably why.
Yeah. But you still have the question of whether or not if this hump were to divert truck traffic off of Lincoln, the question remains, where would it go? And would it go the right direction? I know that there have certainly been semi-trucks that get stuck on Parsons Street, which is trying to turn onto North Street. We've had sidewalk repaired there several times after North Street was rebuilt. There was one that was pinched up against the utility pole because it couldn't make the turn because it should never have been anywhere near there to begin with. So I'm a little concerned about just, as has been mentioned, pushing these vehicles off onto the other side streets, onto Elizabeth and Orchard and Parsons and Bay Avenue.
We've had we've had discussions about having them turn around in the fairgrounds, which actually is an industrial area, and I don't know if that's even still on anyone's radar, but there is a lot of room. There's lots of trucks that go down there for events and such, and they could turn around there. They don't have to turn around in our residential neighborhoods.
But they're not turning around, they're going through, right?
Well, if they're turning on Parsons, et cetera,
yeah.
they're trying to
Or they miss Lincoln.
Or they miss Lincoln, right.
Yeah, they miss Lincoln.
Yeah, but they, you know.
They're trying to avoid the truck eating bridge.
Even if it
right.
cuts
it's hard
down
to know.
A lot.
I'm sure there's a variety of reasons.
Yeah. I'm going to say, we're hoping that once they talk to each other, they'll just all smarten up
and
go
down
straight
down
Damon Road.
Like they're supposed
but,
to.
I mean, if you get, you're still going to get some. Okay. We know that. It's not going to stop them all.
Well, I want to kind of bring the conversation back, and we've been discussing this for a while now, and I'm cognizant of the time. We've got half an hour left and other items to get to. I'd be more comfortable if we can go away and answer some of the things that have been raised, like the number of tickets that have been given out on Lincoln Avenue, the possibility of a children's sign, a warning that there are children there sign. A little more thought before we act on whether we want to do a temporary speed bump, and also if one is actually available, if we would have to purchase one. I do think it's worth talking about an alternative turnaround for the purpose of traffic calming and taking trucks off of Lincoln Avenue. I think that's important to study a little bit more and come back to that. And I think the value of this meeting and the last meeting was looking at the new data and sort of, in my opinion, has kind of evolved to the point where speeding is one thing and the trucks are another. So that's what I would like to do and just kind of leave it there for now. That's what I suggest. Because otherwise, I don't think we're going to stop at this point. So, any other discussion or comments on that? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we have these items left. Item D, the question of the addition of a stop sign on Maple Street at the intersection of Maple Street and Nonotuck Street, and review of the DPW analysis. We started this, did we start this last time, or was this one that we just didn't get to at all? I can't remember. We certainly didn't reach a resolution on it. Basically, a resident has asked for a stop sign at that location. You know where it is. It's kind of where you curve up past Chemoplastica. And the recommendation of DPW was a yield sign is warranted at that location, but not a stop sign. Is that correct? Yeah. For the record, members of the commission received the email I forwarded from Ms. Corman, Louise Corman, today. So everyone has that email. The gist of the email is she supports a stop sign and thinks it's important to have that there. So is there any discussion on this question? Noting there are no residents from the neighborhood there, but anything else to add besides the fact that DPW thinks a yield sign is what's required? No? Okay.
Brian, the chief does go up in that neighborhood and spend some time out there, and she wanted to relay that traffic coming off of Riverside onto Maple and then through that intersection, there were a significant amount of cars that were traveling at a fairly good rate of speed for that turn and then back onto Nonotuck there. So she just wanted me to pass that along to the group as well.
From Riverside onto Nonotuck through that turning right?
Riverside onto the Maple Street, that's what we're talking about.
Onto Maple Street,
yeah,
sorry.
So she did go speak with some residents there and spend some time there.
Okay. Was there an opinion from the department about signage?
So right there, there's no signs now, is that correct?
I believe there are no signs. And the DPW is recommending a yield sign, and some residents are asking for a stop sign.
I don't know if she had a recommendation.
Okay. Why not a stop sign, just to play devil's advocate? I know it's like speed bumps. If everyone got their way, we'd live on one giant speed bump with a bunch of stop signs coming. But is there any reason?
Yes.
Did you repeat that?
It was in your package last time, and there
okay.
were warrants for stop signs.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain criteria that are required to be met Okay. If they need to warrant that for them, the stop sign is not warranted.
Okay. An elegant answer. No, I definitely understand the need to follow the procedure. Look at the warrants, so.
So I'm a little fuzzy on it. So this is on a yield sign or a stop sign at essentially at the base of the hill.
No, it's across the street.
That's still Maple Street?
Yes, it is. It's coming the other direction. It's as though you were. So at the top of the page is the base of the hill.
Oh, that's right. And then this is Riverside that comes in.
Yes.
Interesting.
Okay. Well, I mean, a yield sign is better than a stop, better than nothing, I would assume. So, I mean, yeah, is sure.
I live on Riverside Drive and I go that way all the time and I know what goes on at the intersection and I don't live on the corner. And I think if you're, depending upon how you see it, it looks like it's blind. But from my perspective as a driver, heading up Maple, which is approaching Nonotuck, the sight line is excellent to the left. So even if you're around the corner at say 10 miles an hour, you're in the right lane. So there shouldn't be a car there. And typically I'm going to turn left on the Maple to continue up to Florence Center. You do have to slow at that point to make that left-hand turn. I think a yield sign would be very appropriate. A stop sign certainly would work too. Some people would think that would be the more conservative approach, but if it's not warranted, it's not warranted. I think it would make perfect sense to install the yield sign. And I forget what the accident report showed, if it showed much there. But I can see if you were down the street a little bit further and you saw cars coming out at speed, that would look scary. But the sight line is excellent. There's no obstruction to the view. There's no parked cars, there's no trees, there's no shrubs. If you're looking to the left and you're approaching at a, it is like an entry ramp to a highway. And the angle is in your favor, let's put it that way. So it
sounds
just
like
seems
you're making
like,
motion.
From a motorist perspective, it seems like it's a fairly reasonable maneuver.
Okay. It sounds like you're making a motion to recommend that a yield sign be installed.
I am making that motion.
I know you so well at this point. Is there a second?
No.
I knew you were going to do it. Thank you. Any discussion? Further discussion on a recommendation to add a yield sign at this location? Yeah.
Just please follow what Gary was saying. That there's nothing there now. Chief Casper seems, she went up, and there seems to be a lot of traffic speeding. Let's at least do something. Put the yield sign in, and let's monitor it and see. See if there's either an increase in tickets or accidents. Monitor the situation.
Okay.
See what the residents say. But at least it's a step.
Okay.
And it may be the golden step.
Okay. I think that's very wise advice. Thank you. Any other discussion? On the question to recommend a yield sign be installed at this location, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that passes unanimously. Great. Well, item E is the question of the addition of a stop sign on Henry Street at the intersection of Henry Street and Ventresfield Road and Montague Avenue, review of the DPW analysis. Similar situation, we have DPW analysis saying that no additional signage of any kind is warranted at this location. And also, to Mr. Albert Fisher's point, there isn't really anyone from the neighborhood here to talk about this today. So with that, those two facts being what they are, I don't know if we want to take any action on this, but it is posted on the agenda so we can sort of discuss it if anyone wants to say anything about this question. And if not, I mean, it might be a reasonable course of action just not to take action. And I could, it's Ward 3, I could continue to talk to the neighborhood, but it sounds like the recommendation from DPW is just no action. Would that be acceptable? Yeah, okay. All right, so I'll take that as our kind of consensus opinion and move on to item F. Item F is South Street bicycle and pedestrian improvements. Possible referral of issue for study to the bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee. This has to do with safety for bicyclists along South Street. And at one point last year, I think you recall, someone came in and talked about bad experiences they've had as a cyclist. Councilor, I don't know if you want to speak at all at that point, because he actually contacted you first before coming.
Yeah, and actually, I think I came, I was here with him that day.
Right.
So when, specifically, this he was talking about next to the Academy of Music. So the crosswalk that had been there, that had gone into the park, was removed, and or was moved closer to the bridge. Sort of an unintended consequence of that is that the bike lane, now cars move over more quickly because those barrels have been removed. So they move, if they're going to take a right, if they're coming towards downtown, down South Street, if they're going to take a right onto South Street, they're going to get into that, if they're going to take a right onto Main Street, they're going to get into that right lane sooner, which means they are kind of cutting into where that bike lane is. And actually, the marking for the bike lane just sort of disappears at one point. And so I've heard many people complain about this, and the gentleman that had come here had actually been knocked off his bike by a car that had just kind of swerved into there or kind of moved into there and cut him off there. So the question is how, you know, what can we do at that, particularly at that point, to make it safe? We've created this bike lane to bring bicyclists down to the center of town into Main Street, and then we kind of leave them nowhere to go at that point. So what can we do to help that situation?
I think that you really ought to move this over to the other committee, which is looking at all of those kinds of questions, and encourage the gentleman, if you have connections to him, to come, among other things, to this meeting. I really do.
Okay.
Because these are the kinds of questions that are being very specifically looked at.
I have a question. What is the relationship between the bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee and the consultants and their whole process? I sometimes don't know what the subcommittee does. It's sort of like...
Right at the moment, the subcommittee is kind of the touchstone back and forth for that process.
Okay.
I mean, he's been meeting with us, and we've been going to those meetings, and we've been marking up maps and having discussions about those maps, so it really is an interactive process.
Okay, well that's good to know, and therefore it might make sense to just refer the whole question to the subcommittee and ask for a specific reply of some kind from the consultants and bring this specific matter to their attention and say, what do you think about this? Within the context of a greater study, but still.
I was gonna say, if you want to take whatever articulation, put it on here and send that over, it will go to the committee, which I think is probably already looking at those questions in that area.
Okay.
Because there's a whole question of shift with the bus lanes and with State Street, and I mean all of that stuff's kind of together there, and it's all being looked at. There's going to be a special corridor session looking at Main Street pedestrian biking.
Mm-hmm.
If you yourself are interested in knowing what's going on, ask for the currently marked up maps that they have, and they can send them to you. They're very interesting, actually. And then you can see where the issues and concerns are being articulated.
Well, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And just any other comments on this item? We're almost done. But on the specific point, does it make sense? I mean, if the Ward 4 counselor maybe sends an email to who's the chair of the bicycle pedestrian subcommittee? Director Fido. See.
Invisible man.
So maybe that could be done, and then we could make a request just to get some kind of response back. Okay, can we just do that without objection? We don't have to vote on that. All right, anything else on that item? If not, is there any new business today? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.